Amen. Good evening to everybody on this radio broadcast. You're tuned in tonight on CWM Radio Show with your host, Apostle Michael Branch, and we're ready to welcome him, amen, to the airwaves. So get back, sit back, and ready to get a word from the Lord on Tuesday night, each and every week at 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. We give God the glory, the praise, and honor for allowing us opportunity to share his word to the nation. Amen. So come on, let's give our Apostle Michael Branch a hand clap.
Praise be unto God. Once again, this is Apostle Branch. I want to thank everybody that may be watching, those of you that may view this later. Amen. I just want to respond to my sister. My sister just texted me and said, Apostle, why you never show your face when you do live? The real reason why I do it is because it's not about me. It's about the word of God. It's about the worship that I give him. It's about, I just want him to be lifted up. It ain't about me. And if more of us would take that approach, you'll start seeing less faces. Hallelujah. And people would start receiving more word. It ain't about me, daughter. I appreciate it. Glory be to God. And I thank you for your compliments. But it's not about me. It's about the word of God. Hallelujah. For those of you may have your Bible, you might want to jot this scripture down, because I believe it's going to help us as we begin to go into this little quick word about fellowship. I'm coming from 1 Samuel, the 18th chapter, and I'm going to start with the first verse, and I think I'm going to read about 5. And it says, "And it came to pass, when he had made an end of speaking unto Saul, that the soul of Jonathan was knitted with the soul of David, and Jonathan loved him as his own soul. And Saul took him that day and would let him go no more home to his father's house." In other words, it was almost like Saul had now just adopted David. Wouldn't even let him go back to his own family. Just, no, you're a part of us now. Then Jonathan and David made a covenant, because he loved him as his own soul. And see, that's another thing that is lost in the body of Christ right now, is the definition. It is the outcome of what a covenant is supposed to be. We have a lot of people talk about covenant and don't have a clue as to what the foundation of the word means. Verse 4 says, "And Jonathan stripped himself of the robe that he was upon him, and gave it to David, and his garments, even to his sword, and to the bow, and to his girdle." In other words, everything that Jonathan had on, he gave it to David because of his fellowship with him. Verse 5, last verse. "And David went out whitherso Saul sent him, and behaved himself wisely. And Saul set him over the men of war, and he was accepted in the sight of all the people, and also in the sight of Saul, his servant." May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word. I dare not go any further until I pray. Father, we thank you this day. Father, first and foremost, for allowing us to see another day. We thank you for being our Lord, our Savior, our King. We thank you for being the author and the finisher of who we are. And now we give you glory, honor, and praise. Lord, bless this word. Hallelujah. Bless it right now in the name of Jesus. Hide me and meet me, that you might be seen and heard. And let this word go in the ear of the receiver and pierce the very heart. Hallelujah. That they might be changed in a moment and in the twinkling of an eye. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Powerful exchange between Saul, Jonathan, and David. We know at this point that Saul was the king. But we also know that David had been anointed by Samuel. But Jonathan was Saul's son that had a special love, a special affection for David. Amen. He had a right fellowship. And this is just what I'm trying to talk about today. I'm trying to talk about fellowship. And some of us, hallelujah, and when we start dealing with church and church people, when we start dealing with the body of Christ, we have forgotten what true fellowship really is. We think because we go to church and we sit on the pews and we sit in the chairs and the same person we see every Sunday, we fellowship. No, that's not true fellowship. No, because true fellowship has a bottom line called covenant. My God, let me preach. Oh, let me slow down, though. I didn't get on here to preach, really. I got on here just to talk about fellowship because the Lord put this thing in my spirit. Actually, it hit me even as I was on the stage Saturday night, mastering a ceremony for my uncle's program. And I'm beginning to look, and I know most preachers can contest to what I'm saying. You can be behind the pulpit, and you can be looking across the congregation, and you can begin to see the spirits on people. My God, I'm ready to preach. And you can begin to see a torment in their faces. You can begin to see the desire to really want to worship, but it's something on the inside of them that is holding them back from giving God their best praise. Oh, because they don't know nothing about fellowship. They don't know nothing about the covenant between themselves and God. Listen, let me try this thing here again. See, fellowship. Mm-hmm. Fellowship says that I have a friendly association with you. Amen. It says that we have some kind of camaraderie, some kind of companionship. It says that we are sociable together. Hallelujah. It says that we have a mutual support. Now, the one thing that I want us all to have a mutual support for, it is the cross. My God. We should come together and let not one thing, not nothing in the body or outside of the body keep us from coming together to support the body of Christ, to support the cross, to support, hallelujah, anything that Jesus has implemented in this earth. My God, right here. See, our lack of fellowship, our lack of communication with one another is keeping us from letting it be so it is in heaven, so it is on the earth. You see, there's no lack of fellowship in heaven. But in order for us to have that same kind of a camaraderie here, we got to get in line. We got to find out what is the problem. Why is it that we can't fellowship? Why is it that we can't come together and love on one another the way the Bible tells us? But you know, here's the sad part of it is, y'all, I hope y'all don't mind me just telling the truth. If it's step on your toes, you just step on your toes. Sometimes I step on my own toes, but that's what the word do. You know, it's sad we talk a big game. We talk a big game, hallelujah, especially us so-called Christians. We are always in church. We be the first thing there, last thing to leave. But we are among the biggest hypocrites there is. Some of the people in the world is less of a hypocrite than some of us setting up in the church. Why? Because we are there for the fashion, the form, and the fame. We are there, hallelujah, just so we can have something to talk about. We are there so that we can let somebody see what we bought Saturday night. We are there so, hallelujah, Jesus, I ain't got to get no amens. That's all right. I'm not saying this for an amen. I'm saying it because it's the truth. We are there, hallelujah, just so somebody can see us being at church, but the church ain't in us. We don't have no right fellowship. Now, let me get back to this thing. I want to get back to it because I said right fellowship. Right fellowship has a bottom line or a foundation called covenant. You see, when God makes covenants, God make a covenant so that it don't be broken. God said, my word which I send from my mouth, my word which I give, my word is going to accomplish exactly what I send it to accomplish. Hallelujah. See, but now, can we say, say the same thing on our end, our word. Our word is going to accomplish what comes out of our mouth. I'm not going to take it back. I'm not going to feel sorrowful because of the outcome. Even though I love you and you don't love me, so I got to withdraw my love because it don't come back. No, that's not the way it's supposed to be. A covenant is something that don't supposed to be broken. Fellowship is something that don't supposed to be broken. But wait 1 minute here. I don't want to jump ahead of myself. See, because I like to go to the word of God. The word of God gives us more, hallelujah, to answer for, and gives us a more sensibility of what God was trying to say about fellowship. He says, now, be hospitable to one another without complaint. Glory be to God. Have you ever seen such a mirage of people now? They can only love you when you can do something for them. Our friendship goes just as far as you can go when you're doing something for me. The moment that they hear no is the moment fellowship ends. Come on, y'all know I'm telling the truth. But the word of God says be hospitable to one another without complaint. Why then do you have a complaint when I can't help you, but you're all right when I can? Oh, glory, help me, somebody. Y'all don't like it, but that's all right. Oh, my God, right here. So listen, the word of God. I'm going to just give you the word of God. See, the word of God can stand on its own. The word of God don't need no prop. See, we say that we are Christians. We say we love the Lord, but we don't live what we say. We don't act like what we say. We are not going by the word of God. Well, the adjective that what God said about love, we're not, hallelujah, demonstrating that kind of love. Amen. The word of God said, a new covenant I give to you, that you love one another even as I have loved you, that you also love one another. That's from Romans 12 and 13. You see, even now, love only goes as far as what I can do for you. It's sad. It's sad. Watch this. It's not just among our neighbors. It's not just among our co-workers. Not just among, amen, members of our family. But where it hurts the most is when it comes to fellowship in the church. My God. It hurts when we go to a place that's supposed to be a place of serenity, a place where I can go and just let out my issues and my problems, a place where I can go where I can feel comfortable, a place where I can go, hallelujah, Jesus, and just be me. Hallelujah, don't mind. Hallelujah, letting it out. Glory be to God. Now, I'm supposed to be worried about somebody taking my business and putting it out in the street. But now the church house is now become the gossip house. My God, ain't no fellowship, ain't no right fellowship. Hallelujah, I can't go there now. This is why a lot of us don't even go to church anymore. We sit at home and watch it on television. We'll get our word on Facebook Live. We'll go to Twitter. Hallelujah, we'll go to any kind of other social media. Don't want to be in the church. Why? Because our business did out in the street. No fellowship. Now let's look at this thing as fellowship from church to church. Listen, it's a shame, hallelujah, that you can go to church all the time, but you're just going to your church, man. Well, let's deal with that. Because so sometimes, glory be to God, sometimes you only go to your church. And I understand that you're loyal to your church. You're loyal to your pastor. You're loyal to your leaders. And ain't nothing in the world wrong with that. But the only problem I will have with that if they don't allow you outside fellowship. My God, you see, you don't belong to them, you belong to God, and God told us to love one another. And how can you love me if you don't fellowship with me? So you got 9 churches on one street, and the only church you fellowship in, the one that you're a member of. That ain't fellowship. That's not fellowship. That's not the love that God said, the love. That's not even the love between Jonathan and David. My. Lord, help me here. Well, watch the word of God. I'm going to always take you back to the word. See, because a lot of times, you know, when you're preaching the truth, people don't really want to hear the truth. See, that right there is when you fall out of fellowship and when the truth comes. My God, right here. That's okay, though. That's okay. Philippians says this right here. For it is only right for me to feel this way about you all, because I have in my heart, since both in my imprisonment and in my defense and confirmation of the gospel, you all are partakers of grace with me. Paul was telling the church of Philippi there, he was telling them this right here. Listen, I have come to a place inside of me that says, regardless, hallelujah, of what happens to me, I can be in prison, I can be a free man, I'm content right now, but I'm not going to be content if we don't have fellowship. Glory be to God. This is why he went from church to church, from city to city. I did some research one time. The Bible, if you research it and go into your concordance, said that Paul traveled over 30,000 miles by feet just forming ministries and preaching the gospel and trying to form fellowship. My God, there's got to be something true. There got to be something righteous about the right fellowship. Do God would not have had him getting it in steel, where it wouldn't even be a part of what the body's supposed to be if it was not so that it was important to God. We who have sweet fellowship together walk in the house of God. Hallelujah. That comes from the book of Psalms right there. They were continuously devoting themselves to the apostle teaching and to fellowship, to be the breaking of bread and prayer. Wait a minute here. I just touched on something I want to touch on. I was going to wait and put it on the end, but let me go and say it right here. Let me tell y'all something here. I'm one, if anybody know me, know that I love prayer, because I believe prayer truly changes things. It's not just a cliche to me. It's something that I believe. It's something that I've seen happen in the life of my mom and my grandmom. It's something I've seen happen even in my life of my wife and my children. I know the power of prayer. You can't tell me prayer can't change things. But let me say something here about this thing called prayer. Glory be to God. When we pray, my God, the Bible said that Jesus said, I wanted my house to be known as a house of prayer. In other words, he says, you can call your church anything you want, but let the foundation of it be about prayer. This is how you're going to invite him in. He's going to sup with you. This is how the covenant with him is going to be formed through prayer. But wait one minute. How then can we say that we are true Christians? How then can we say we have true fellowship? How then can we say that we are righteous in the sight of God if we are not praying only, if we are only praying inside our church and not going outside of our church praying? There's got to be some community prayer. There's got to be some in-house prayer. There's got to be some in my neighborhood prayer. There's got to be some prayer at another church. Don't you know that there's going to be some breakers of some bondage in another church because you're going to show up and pray? Don't you know? No, don't get me started here. Don't you know there's a word got to come out of your mouth in somebody else's house that's going to break every chain? Don't you know God has mandated a word in your belly through prayer that's going to pull down the heavens? Good God Almighty. But you can't just do it in your church. You got to come out of the walls. You got to get somewhere. Hallelujah, Jesus. See, the sad part of it is, my God, right here, the very sad part of it is, many of you have been mandated, but you ain't living up to your mandate. Many of you have been called, but you ain't accepting the call. Many of you have assignments, and you're just letting those assignments lay waste. But the moment, good God Almighty, the moment you really, truly need Jesus, you really want him to show up, well, be reminded when he gave you that mandate, when he gave you those assignments. Good God Almighty, did you come through? We ain't getting nowhere because we're not in fellowship. We're not in right covenant. If I tell you I love you, hallelujah, Jesus, that love, as I say all the time, is unconditional. I'm going to love you in the city. I'm going to love you in the field. I'm going to love you going. I'm going to love you coming. You may do something to offend me, but I got enough of Jesus on the inside of me to say, hey, I know it ain't them. It's just some spirit that activated on the inside of them. But the moment they get delivered, I know that we're going to be in right fellowship. We can't at no point now begin to look at our brother brothers and sisters and hold them so totally accountable what they do and say, because there's demons in this land. There's demonic presence, powers and principalities that have made host of them and are acting out. But we must what? Pray. We must still have good fellowship. See, the devil don't want you to have no fellowship. The devil don't want you to love on one another. He don't want you, hallelujah, to look at them and say, I know them better than this. And the way that they're acting now, it's not in their character. So I'm just going to pray. That's all I know to do is pray. Pray in the spirit of meekness. Lest the same thing fall upon me. And I be looked at the very same way. My God, y'all, that's okay. I might just be preaching to myself. That's fine. But I just want to give you the word fellowship. Saturday night, amen, I was on that stage. I looked out across that auditorium, and the Lord was just showing me so much stuff. I was still conducting business on the stage, on the platform, and the Lord was still ministering to me. He said, people come to gatherings such as this to be seen or to see, so that they have something to say. Or because, and you know, again, it's the fashion thing. Well, I just bought something new. I got this outfit. I want to wear it. That's fine. If that's what you, call your fellowship, if that's what you call, you being right with God. But let me tell you something. Such as I said Saturday night, people can get saved at a gospel singing if they come with the right mentality. See, most of the time when people go to a gospel program like that, wait a minute, I didn't open up a can of worms. I got to just tell it all. See, the most of the time we go to these functions like this right here, it is for form and fashion. We don't go there to receive God. We just go there just to see the groups and see how they perform and then to see our neighbors and see our friends. But the thought of it ain't on Christ. You see, every time we come together, we should have Christ as the center part. Ain't that what the group's supposed to be singing about? The goodness of Jesus? But wait one minute here. Let me just go and divert back here, because I'm going to go and tell the whole truth. You see, what happens here is, see, you can sing a lie just like you can tell a lie. Come on, y'all don't like it. I know you don't like it. Yeah. Your favorite group can sing a lie just like the next man can tell a lie. You see, what the problem is, the reason why there is no deliverance at a gospel singing, the reason why nobody's coming to the altar at a gospel singing, is because the majority of them that are singing ain't living what they singing. Their lives are tore up from the floor up, but it's all a performance to them. Jesus Christ. Oh my God, right here. That's all right. Y'all can get mad. That's all right. You get mad with the word of God. You get mad with the truth. Ain't no need to get mad with the messenger. See, somebody got to stand up and start telling the truth. Somebody got to shame the devil. Somebody got to stand in the gap and say, listen, these things should not be. These things should not be. So when it comes to fellowship, we got to start fellowshipping. Amen. So that it is pleasing unto God. Now watch this right here. Watch the world. The world, when they fellowship, spare no expense. Oh my God. It never get too late or too early. Oh my. They don't care who it is, who is with. Amen. They're going to do what they got to do. They're going to come together and they're going to party hard. All late in the wee hours of the night. See, ain't nobody want to stay at church, my God, in the wee hours of the night. No, we came at 7 o'clock. By 8:30, we ready to go. But those that are in the world that are fellowshipping, if they came at 7, oh, my God, they don't even shift gears until about 10:30. And then they're going to be there until about 4 in the morning. See, they got that fellowship of among them. They gonna ride or die. But where the rider dies in the house of God, my Savior. Where? Oh, glory be to God. Ain't no fellowship. We are some of the most two-faced, hypocritical, hallelujah, dishonorable people there is. And we call ourselves Christians. Y'all get mad with me. That's fine. I don't care. I'm not going to stop doing what I've been mandated to do. And that's to preach the gospel and the good news of Jesus Christ. I'm just preaching the word. I'm just giving it to you in a language you can understand. Oh, glory be to God. We must fellowship. We must fellowship. Watch this right here. I'm going to read this scripture again because I want to, and then I'm going to end. I'm going to play a little bit more worship and we're going to call it a day. Now, and when I read from 1 Samuel 18, I read something here that Jonathan did. I mean, David did. Here's what Saul said. Saul said, and Saul took him that day and would let him go no more home to his father's house. Then Jonathan and David made a covenant because he loved him as his own soul. Now listen, that fellowship and that love that they had for David, it superseded anything to the point where they made them a figment of their household. To the point where they said, listen, you ain't even got to go home. You can stay right here. Where that kind of fellowship at right now? When you have people that are coming to your house and you can love on them away, that you can say, listen, we ain't even got room enough for you, but not yet. I can make a pallet on the floor so you can sit. I can make a cot right over here in the corner so you can lay your head. I ain't got enough food to even feed all of my children, but what we got, we're going to share with you. This is fellowship. My God, right here. This is right fellowship. This is the kind of fellowship God wants us to have toward one another. Not this bickering, not this backbiting, not this hallelujah, defaming one's character, but he wants us to love, hallelujah, love, so that that covenant and that relationship, that fellowship will be concreted such as his blood. My God, right here. I'm here to tell y'all right now, without it, we won't make it. Without it, there is no going to the cross. I don't care what church you're a member of. I don't care what organization you're a member of. I don't care what title you have. But if you don't have that right fellowship, my God, come on, help me preach. If you don't have that right fellowship, if you're a covenant breaker, my God, you are out of the will of God. Thank y'all. I'm going to stop right there. I tell you, I had to come in here with that thing because that thing bothered me. I was coming up the highway, amen, even last night, and that thing was hitting me in my spirit. The covenant, the covenant, the covenant. Are we breaking covenant with Jesus? Are we breaking covenant with the cross? Hallelujah. That thing, that scripture that says, so it is in heaven, so it shall be on earth. Ain't no way it can be that way. Not with the kind of fellowship that we have. Not with the kind of hallelujah love that we are describing, the love that we are implementing toward one another. This ain't love. Hallelujah. Somebody said, what love got to do with it? Love got everything in the world to do with it. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, glory be to God. This ain't no Tina Turner movie. This is real life. My Savior, Lord, today. We must have right fellowship. Right fellowship. Right fellowship. Right fellowship. Glory be to God. Right fellowship. And when the right fellowship come about, my Savior, then we can get in a place with God. See, there are places in God that we can go, hallelujah, where the worries and the cares of the world don't be so heavy. See, it's so heavy now because we are fighting warfare, and there's a lot of warfare that we ain't even got to be a part of. See, y'all heard that scripture. The Bible says, he says, now the battle is not yours. It belongs to the Lord. You see, that is true. Now, there are still some battles we got to fight. But we might not have to extend so much energy in fighting them if we were in right fellowship with Jesus, because he'll give you the strategies. He will give you the plan. He will show you the steps. He says, the steps of a righteous man is ordered by the Lord. He will show you how to get around the enemy, how to let the enemy fall into his own trap. My God, right here. Oh, my Savior. But we got to be in right fellowship. In right fellowship. In right fellowship. I'm going to pray in just a minute. I'm going to pray and we're going to go. Yeah.
You've been listening to CWM Radio. That was your radio host, Apostle Michael Branch. Join him every Tuesday night at 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time for a word from the Lord. Amen. What an on-time word. I was just thinking about this word on today. How many times we give. We give to folks. We give credit. We let people do this and we give them that. But yet when we stop, yet when we can no longer do it, they no longer want to deal with us. They no longer want to communicate with us. I just sit thinking this in my spirit today. How many times we pour out, but when we can't do it no more, you don't see them. When we can't do it no more, people don't come around. Ain't that an on-time word? Where's the fellowship? Where's the fellowship today? Amen. We all feel like we've taken ownership like the slave master. We can't fellowship. But if you're teaching, amen, it shouldn't be a problem because we are all God's children and we should fellowship one to another. Amen. What an on-time message. Amen. If you just tuned in tonight and you missed the broadcast, if you missed the word earlier, at the end of this broadcast, you can go back and listen on the replay. Because you will be blessed by this message on this evening. Amen, amen, amen. Listen, I want to thank each and every one of you for tuning in support of this radio broadcast. Join Apostle Michael Branch next week at 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Now, tomorrow is Wednesday, hump day, and I know somebody out there need a word from the Lord in the middle of the week. You've been dealing with some issue. You've been dealing with some stuff. Come on in and hear a word. At 8 o'clock, we have Restoring Souls to Christ radio show with the radio host, Pastor Brenda D. Wilson. At 8 o'clock, Eastern Standard Time, show up and tune in and listen to what the Lord is saying through the woman of God. And then at 9 o'clock on Wednesday, we have Men to Men Talk Back, the Talk Up Show, with yours truly, radio host Pastor Nino, and co-host Pastor Carl Young. We are going to do part two of what's blinding our people today. What's blinding our people today? We've had a lot of listeners and they enjoyed it so much. They said it need to be a part two. So we're going to bring part two of what's blinding our people today. There's so much foolery. There's so much trickery. There's so much things that people are being swindled and bamboozled with that we want to bring that to your attention. We're knocking at their door. We're going to blow them doors down because we are bringing things to light and we're keeping it 100 on Men to Men Talk Back, the Talk Up Show, 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time tomorrow. So 8 o'clock, Restoring Souls to Christ. Amen. And at 9, Men to Men Talk Back. We thank you again. We love you with the love of the Lord and continue to enjoy this music and pat your feet, clap your hand. For this is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice. Let us sound out the alarm. Come on, come on. Lift your voice up in Zion and let somebody know that we serve the true and living God, all-powerful God, all-knowing God, the creator of this world and the next. He's never lost a battle. There's no other God beside him. There's nothing that can touch our God. Hallelujah. We're praising the Lord. Come on.